Please welcome the Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of the Walt Disney Company, Robert Iger, and the new Dean of the USC Annenberg School of Communication and Journalism, Willow Bay.
Thank you. Oh my gosh, that was so nice.
Thank you.
David, we will be your anchor tenants anytime. Anytime. Thank you. Thank you, Bob. I have to say that I think that Bob is a better academic husband than I am a corporate wife. You've been incredibly generous in your time with Annenberg and with USC, so thank you. And while I'm thanking a little bit, since at the journalism school we have one of the top public relations programs in the country, I do have to thank Xenia Mucha, Disney's chief of communications, because without Xenia's help, Bob would not be sitting here today. So it really wasn't me, it was actually Xenia. So Xenia, thank you. And Xenia hires lots of Annenberg grads. So let's keep that up, Zen. Thank you. And you know, you never know what a day in the Iger Bay household is going to bring. Some news hit the wires this morning after you had left the house. put that aside, but we'll discuss it a little bit later if that's okay.
Fine with me.
Okay. We don't have a sizzle reel for you. I'm sorry, so I'm going to have to do the sizzle reel bit for you. So just to set the stage, cue the music. Oh, wait, I didn't get rights and clearances for that, so we don't have any music either. Okay, we'll take this. Just to situate you within the Disney empire, a global entertainment company, one of the most recognizable brand names in the world, Pixar, Disney, Marvel, ESPN, ABC, Lucasfilm. Last count, market cap of $180 billion. I didn't check it today. You probably did, but I didn't. 200,000.
Slightly less.
200,000 employees around the world. Consumer products division now has 11 franchises, generating more than $1 billion each in retail sales. Oh yeah, and you just opened your sixth theme park in Shanghai. So give an array of all of those businesses spread across the globe in several different industries. Can you just give us a sense of what your day is like and how you set your priorities?
My days are long and my days are busy, I can tell you that. Well, you know that, actually. By the way, someone said, oh, your wife is interviewing you, that will be easy. And then I reminded them that no one cross-examines one tougher or harder than a spouse. Right? Anyway, my days are fascinating because, as you would imagine, a company like ours that does business in every corner of the world and is in many different businesses in many places in the world, the day can be challenging, can be exhilarating, can be frustrating, can be exciting, can be depressing, although there aren't that many of those because, you know, we're the happiest place on earth or whatever. but the great thing about my job is I get a chance to exercise many different muscles and be as ambidextrous or as multidextrous, if there's such a word, or dextrous as I possibly can be. Because there are so many different subjects, so many different issues, so many different things to think about. So a few things. First of all, just in terms of how I allocate my time, I'm a big believer, and I exhort the people who I work closest with the company to never spend all your time in the present or in the future. In other words, you need to do both. Mm-hmm. You need to spend a lot of time in the present, so I call it foot in the present, to operate your business as well. That's what's expected of us. And you have to always have a foot in the future, because we are, all of our businesses, even though we're far from a startup and many of our businesses are traditional and considered mature or maturing, the marketplace that we do business in is so dynamic and changing so fast that you've got to have a foot in the future at all times, thinking about where should we go, where can we go, who's going to stop us from going in a certain direction. So I exhort everyone to both be a strategist and be an operator. Beyond that, in terms of how I spend my time, I try hard to balance a few things. First of all, I try to spend time where I think I can add value. Whether it's just leadership value in terms of directing people, or whether it's value in terms of a creative eye from 43 years in the business, or whether it's value just in terms of giving people the confidence and the support, and of course the capital to fulfill whatever it is that they're trying to fulfill. So that's one bucket, is where can I bring value? Mm-hmm. Another bucket is obviously exercising the responsibility that I have as the CEO of the company. There are things that I simply have to do. The big decisions in terms of capital allocation, certainly things like big acquisitions, dealing with a lot of the most critical issues from a public-facing perspective, managing the brand on an Uber basis or an executive editor basis, to name a few. And then beyond that, I try to spend time in things that I actually get stimulated by and that are fun. I have the luxury now of 12 years almost as CEO of the company, and a team that is operating really well, which gives me the freedom to actually do things that I enjoy. And I know that sounds somewhat trite, or maybe even a little bit unfair, but it's sort of the privilege of this office at this point in my tenure. So if I have an opportunity to watch the Star Wars 8, which is called The Last Jedi, in an afternoon because the director has just delivered a cut, I guarantee you I'm going to do that before I have an hour meeting on benefits or something like that. Nothing wrong with benefits, but this, Star Wars or it's just a lot more fun. And I know that sounds kind of funny, but I actually do get a chance to, the nice thing is I can allocate my time pretty freely.
And so where are you, where are the places that are bringing you the fun these days?
Well, first of all, I love what the opportunities technology is providing us. I thought the presentation just before us was really interesting because I spent time on Tuesday afternoon in a lab at Glendale with a gadget on my head that at some point will be a lot lighter and a lot more comfortable and maybe even feel non-existent, having a lightsaber duel with a stormtrooper, just to get a sense for how that technology, AR, will enable us to extend our storytelling, mm-hmm. bring our characters and an IP closer to the consumer, maybe even to the house, as a for instance. So anything that has to do with technology creating opportunity for us, I find very enjoyable. The creative process at its highest level is at times frustrating, but often, and fortunately for us, really enjoyable. So when you sit in a darkened theater, 30 feet away from your office, and the lights go down, and up comes that Lucas logo, and you hear that John Williams Star Wars music, and you're watching a Star Wars film for the first time. I mean, it's unbelievably exciting and incredibly fun. And of course, walking down a street or an area in one of our theme parks, whether it's in Shanghai or in Hong Kong or right here in Anaheim, and watching people enjoy what it is that we have created is also incredibly fun and very fulfilling.
Where did you develop your creative instincts? Because, I mean, as you and I have discussed, I've seen in recent years you get more involved, for example, in the film business. But those instincts, as kind of an editor-in-chief, if you will, have really just didn't emerge in the past couple of years, did they?
No, well, first, I started in the business 43 years ago. That's a long time, actually. And many of the jobs that I had over that period of time, I managed creative processes. I was never quite a creator. Well, I did, try a little bit at producing and directing early on. But most of what I did is I managed other creators and helped bring their dreams and their product to the world. And with that came knowledge of language, of creativity. And a lot of people have creative instincts. All of us do, actually. You taste food and you have a reaction to it. You see a photo or a painting, or you watch a movie or listen to a song. You react to it and it touches you creatively. But a lot of people don't have the ability to articulate specifically what it is about it that they liked, or articulate to the creator what it is about it that you liked or didn't like and how the creator may even think about improving it, as for instance. So I've honed skills over time that enable me to be in the room with really talented creators and talk about story and talk about film and talk about what it is they've buildings and rides in terms of the parks they've created. So a lot of that was just practice and experience. What's happened in the 12 years that I've had the job that's pushed me more in certain directions creatively is, first of all, once I established with the team what the strategic priorities of the company needed to be, and once we started executing against them, I was able to spend less time focusing on, because creating strategy is almost harder than implementing strategy, because it just takes a lot more brain power, in my opinion. But once we did that, it freed me up to spend more time on the creative side. The other thing that's happened is, if you look at the company today, is the value of some of our creativity in its highest form, particularly these big tentpole movies, these franchises, the value of that across our company and over time is so great and has become so much greater that it becomes, going back to how I established my priorities, almost something that I must be involved with because of the potential to do, you know, so many, to be so meaningful for the company long term.
So when you first assumed the CEO role and you became steward of the Disney brand, you really outlined a strategy that focused on the value of that brand and growing it over time. Why were you so convinced then, or were you convinced then, that big brands and premier brands would grow in value over time, or did you just believe in the Disney brand?
Well, I believed in the Disney brand, but the Disney brand needed a lot of care and feeding at that point to make it a stronger, more must-have brand in the world. What hit me, and I think it ties back to some of my fascination or fixation with technology, and this is back in 2004, 2005, is that technology was enabling the creation and distribution of a lot more intellectual property, a lot more creativity. That there was, I was starting to see the beginnings of an explosion of choice in terms of how people spend their time enjoying creativity or accessing creativity. And that was daunting in many ways because it could cause you to, one, conclude there's going to be a lot more competition, two, conclude that the market's going to fragment so much that anything you make is going to be smaller than it may have been in a world where the market hadn't fragmented as much. But what I ultimately concluded was that in a sea of incredible choice, of, you know, this proliferation well beyond what we ever imagined of content, that brands, if managed well, if really cared for and nurtured well, would actually be more valuable and stand taller in that environment than the opposite. And I can get to that, and there are examples of how that has happened. And so I looked at the movies we were making. We were making more non-Disney movies than Disney movies. Mm-hmm. So we got out of making, at that point, mostly non-Disney movies and focused on just Disney. I know that sounds odd. You'd expect that we were as Disney, we're making more, but we were making movies under Touchstone brand and Miramax brand, and earlier than that, there was a Hollywood Pictures brand. A lot of those brands didn't mean anything in this sea of choice. The Disney brand did. And then buying Pixar was done in part because that brand had emerged similarly as Disney, as well as the using the technology and the people and the talent and the storytellers to enhance everything that was Disney. And Marvel fit the same category, and Lucasfilm, which is really Star Wars, the same thing. So if you look at 2016, there are over 700 movies made in the United States and thousands made in the world. We made 10, and those 10 had 20% of the global box office, and the top five movies of the year were movies that we made. And it's not, they were good movies, so it's not just a coincidence that they were branded, but they were good movies, all branded Marvel, Pixar, Disney, Star Wars. That was it. And with all of that choice, those movies stood tall.
So what's going on there? What's driving, in a world of, with the atomization of content, the fragmentation of markets, that's driving consumption towards blockbuster, and not just blockbuster movies, but sort of blockbuster experiences?
I think a few things are happening. First of all, I think inherently people, even with all this choice, gravitate toward what they perceive to be popular or what is known to be popular or what they hear other people have validated as being good and worthwhile. That's one thing. And actually, interestingly enough, technology is enabling even more of that. How many times do you open up an app or go to go to iTunes, as a for instance, and the recommendations mm-hmm. that are made are either recommendations that are based on your prior likes and tastes, or recommendations that are made because they've deemed popular. You see a list. What are the 10 most popular downloads on iTunes? Or you go to an album, which is such an anachronism, but you go to some musician or whatever has just put out 12 songs, and you look at the 12 songs, and the three best or most popular are starred. So you listen to them first, and the chances are you're going to buy those. So the technology today is actually pushing people even more into what is popular. And I think that's pretty interesting. And another thing that fascinated me, and I think The Economist had a story about this recently, in 2016, 8.6 million different songs were purchased in the United States. 8.6 million were purchased at least once, actually. 96% of them were purchased less than 100 times. It means only 4% of those songs were purchased more than 100 times, and 47% of them were purchased only once. So 3.7 million, something like that, of those songs were purchased only once. So what that says is that 4% of all of that music mm-hmm. was bought more than 100 times, and that's because people are gravitating again toward what is popular. So going all the way back to our strategy to focus on these brands and to put so much capital, really, and the capital is money, it's technology, it's people, into making sure they're great, has really worked for us and has enabled us in this great explosion of choice mm-hmm. to continue to stay at or near the top of those charts. Doesn't mean we're not going to have failure. Every once in a while we do end up with a film that just was not as good as we had hoped it would be. But when they are good, the power of them and the economic value of them is extraordinary. Mm-hmm. This past weekend is a good example of a film we put out, Beauty and the Beast, which in the first weekend did more than the first film, Beauty and the Beast, did in its entire run.
Who saw Beauty and the Beast? Anybody?
Not enough of you.
Wow.
You're wasting your time
here.
Wow,
this is not a blockbuster room.
This is not the audience for Beauty and the Actually.
You just said 107 million. There's a lot of people in this room yeah. should have bought those tickets.
Yeah, true.
I don't know. Go do it. It's really
Anyway, good. What I was getting at is that did... I don't know how much this weekend, but it was 220 some odd million in the U.S. in 4 days, and we passed over 400 million yesterday in the world in 4 days. And that's the power of the brand, the power of great storytelling, told well, using technology to enhance it, by the way, the power of distribution, the distribution today, even for the traditional big screen movie business, is better than it used to be. Mm-hmm. And it's the power of, I'll call it, global recommendation engine that manifests itself in so many different ways.
And where
ways.
Does social media play into that, and how are you seeing social media used in driving the success of blockbusters or not?
Well, I think it's very powerful. First of all, it's a powerful tool that we use for marketing. And when we launch a trailer, which is typically done today on a social media platform, and it is a trailer of something that people are anticipating, and it's a good trailer, and we don't have to spend that much more money on it than to distribute it than we certainly used to when we have to buy television spots around the world, for instance, which we still do because there's still some value there. But that trailer then gets shared millions and millions of times around the world and seen so many times. And before you know it, there's an anticipation. Basically, you've got a marketing engine that's happened just because you've made a trailer and pushed it one button. You don't even have to spend much money doing it. So that clearly, that has a big impact. And of course, when people see something that is good, they share that experience. Just saw Beauty and the Beast, fantastic, take mm-hmm. your kids, and on and on and on. So that has, I think, a profound effect on us. And by the way, the opposite can be true. You cannot hide creative failure these days at all. And everybody knows if something stinks, they know right away. You don't get another shot at all. It is dead. You get that vote on whether something is successful or not yeah. immediately. We put the movie out Thursday night, but I definitely knew Friday morning whether this thing was going to be a success or not globally. Because the people voted. Just all you had to do was go on Facebook and find out.
So let's talk for a second about your own social media use and how you use that. You've recently joined Twitter. Why?
I don't know. It seemed like it was pretty effective for some certain president. I figured I might as well give it a shot. First of all, I've been on Twitter.
By the way, I am very mindful of those pre-dawn tweets. They will not be happening in our house as long as I'm up.
That would be true. That would be true. We get up early, but I only read. I've been on Twitter for a while because I was really curious about the power of the platform, how it was used, but I was not using my name. I know that's probably illegal or whatever, but and then I decided that I could use it as a tool to communicate. When you mentioned earlier 200,000 employees and global customer base that's always interested in the next thing that we're doing, I thought that I could, one, communicate more effectively or in a different way to our employees around the world, and also have an opportunity to communicate to our consumers or potential consumers too. It was that simple.
And have you been surprised by the experience of either engaging with people on Twitter or the reaction to you being on Twitter?
Four tweets. And I don't know how long. I'm being very careful.
Mm-hmm. And but you've responded to some people.
I have, yeah. Nothing surprises me about it. It's kind of nice to every once in a while read someone that says something nice about me, and I find there's a lot out there that is really nasty too, and maybe that's good. Keep my feet on the ground. Keep me humble.
All right, let's talk movies a little bit. Let's talk Star Wars. So what can you tell us about the future of that franchise? You're off to the resurgence is off to a phenomenal start with The Force Awakens and then Rogue One. What can you tell us about what's ahead?
Well, when we bought Lucasfilm, we were going to make three films, which would have been 7, 8, and 9, because George made 6, and Force Awakens was the 7th. And The Last Jedi, which comes out in December, is the 8th. And there's a 9th one being written and just going into early production by a director named Colin Trevorrow, and we're really excited about that. I've seen 8, and 8 is quite good. Picks up where 7 left off, and we're really excited about it. I can't disclose much about it because that's not what we do right now.
You can disclose a little about it, though.
No, not even to you. No.
Come on.
Every once in a while, I watch dailies on my laptop in bed and under the covers, particularly since we have teenage boys. What I can say is we've had to deal with tragedy this past year because mm-hmm. Carrie Fisher passed away tragically in December, and she appears throughout 8. And what I can say about that is she is an 8, and we're not changing 8 to deal with her passing. So her performance, which we're really pleased with, remains as it was in 8. Mm-hmm. As I know, we had in Rogue One, we created digitally a few characters, mm-hmm. one that had an actor that actually passed away but had been in an earlier Star Wars film. We're not doing that with Carrie, although technology gives us the ability to do so many different things today. But 8 is a I think just as satisfying as 7 was. We were really proud of it, and it's a combination of drawing from the great heritage mm-hmm. that was George Lucas's Star Wars, but also bring it to new places with new characters. And then we're actually shooting now an origin story of Han Solo, which will come out in 2018. 2018. And that picks up Han Solo when he was 18 years old and takes him through when he was 24. And there are a few things that happened significant in Han Solo's life, like acquiring a certain vehicle and meeting a certain Wookiee. That will happen in this film. But you'll also discover how he got his name. So it's interesting. It's good. We're excited about that. And then we're just starting to talk about what happens to Star Wars after 9, and it's way too early and certainly nothing that I can reveal, but we've got a creative team actually thinking about what could be another decade and a half of Star Wars stories.
Okay.
Kind of mind-blowing to spend an afternoon with a creative team talking about that. You know, where could you go? Where should we go? And that goes into the category of fun, by the way.
Where might you be going?
to a galaxy far, far away. Thank you for that setup.
Bada bing.
It's interesting because I that'll all happen, you know, after I'm out of the company. But it's interesting dealing with things that are that far out. That I'm hoping to leave my whomever my successor is with an awful lot going on, an awful lot to enjoy.
Great. Well, you know, selfishly, Mark Hamill is an Annenberg family, Annenberg parents, and they've been very generous to the school. So we hope to see a lot of Mark Hamill in the years ahead. Just saying. It would help the new dean greatly.
You know, by the way, for those of you who saw Force Awakens, Mark Hamill, Luke Skywalker, was only in the last shot for, 15 seconds or something and didn't have a talking role. And I remember when we signed him up to do Star Wars 7, he was, you know, really excited because, first of all, it was work, and secondly, it was very important work for him. And then he got the script, and I'm envisioning Mark at home, and he gets the script, 120 pages, and he's through 118, and he's not in it yet. And then he gets to it, and it never says, and Luke Skywalker said. He's got to be crazy.
And?
He was great. After we kind of brought him down a little bit from the ledge, he has a big role in 8.
He's good.
And a lot of talking.
Let's talk about Shanghai a little bit. 17 years in the making. So a couple things there. One is just give us an update on how the park is doing, any surprises, anything you learned about opening in that market, which was, by any measure, an extraordinary accomplishment for the company and an incredible partnership for the company and Chinese government.
It was a 17-year journey for me. I was sent to Shanghai to survey property by Michael Eisner in 1998 or 9, and identified this big piece of land in Shanghai. It was clear to us that Shanghai was the market in China to go to. And it was, I guess, 17 years, maybe even 18, from the moment I set foot on the property, which was a village, to the moment I cut the ribbon with the Chinese government to open this past June. So that is quite a journey. And it was complicated for a number of reasons. The regulation and logistics and government relations and just dealing with building something as complex. These are not cookie-cutter structures. They're much more complicated structures than even the tallest high-rise building, in which there are many in Shanghai, but many of them are cookie-cutter in nature, where each floor is the same. When you build a very high-end attraction, particularly using today's technology, you're building a skin, which is the attraction, what it looks like to the outside world. You're building an entertainment shell inside that people will experience that will help deliver the entertainment experience, and you're building usually a ride technology. And even just making steel and using steel in a way that we use it was something that had not been done in China before. So there was a lot of complexity. Fortunately, the time gave us the ability to think more and more about the culture. Mm-hmm. And the culture actually emerged even more in that period of time. So one of the things that we were particularly focused on during the whole development process, not just what it is we build, but what experience are we providing the people of China, and how relatable can it be? Because when we first had discussions with the Chinese government, they wanted Disneyland. And many of the people we dealt with had come to California or to Florida, or in some cases even to Tokyo and to Paris, had seen much more traditional Disney experience or park, and wanted that in China. And I felt from the beginning, and the team felt, that if we did that, they would feel good that they got a great Disney park, but there were a lot of elements to it that might not be relatable at all to the people of China. And that was really important for us. So as a for instance, Main Street in Disneyland down in Anaheim, or in Orlando, or in Paris, or even in Tokyo, is basically designed after a town that Walt Disney grew up in the middle, Marceline, in the middle of the United States in the early part of the 20th century. I didn't think that that would resonate at all there. And it had a nice sort of nostalgic ring to it when it opened in the United States in the 50s and the subsequent openings in the other places. I didn't think it would ring it true or if it would have any resonance to China. So we eliminated Main Street, which was considered somewhat blasphemous in Disney lore or in Disney religion. Another thing that was really important is that we infuse it with a lot more Chinese elements, mm-hmm. not just characters and stories, but iconography and architecture and just a completely different feel to it. And that took a tremendous amount of attention and care. And I also wanted the people of China to feel that they had built it as well. So we knew we were returning to the construction industry in China, actually physically build it. But even design and detail, I wanted to be the work of Chinese artisans. And so we brought in many from all over China to do the final painting in places. And so it just, even if that is not necessarily seen or known right away to the people who come in, it adds to a collection, mm-hmm. right, that of the experience that brings authenticity to it, is a good word.
We're talking a lot about the future today at this conference. The Shanghai Park is infused with the latest and greatest technology. And what were you able to do there, and how is that informing future development of theme park attractions where you use technology paired with storytelling in innovative ways?
Well, by the way, and it's using technology for two things. It's using technology to tell better stories, and it's also using technology to create better experiences. So navigation, as a for instance, and purchasing. There, the technology leapfrogged other technology that we had used. So the mobile phone becomes incredibly, or the mobile mm-hmm. device, mostly phone, becomes incredibly valuable for people to have a better experience, to whether it's how they buy their tickets or navigating the park, finding out what wait times are on attractions, what restaurant is nearby, all those things seem kind of simple, but being able to build a park in this century and using that technology has a big impact on how people experience it. Of course, the biggest thing you alluded to, and that is how we tell stories in an attraction. So if you look, we just celebrated the 50th anniversary of Pirates of the Caribbean here in Anaheim, which was an attraction that opened just after Walt Disney died, but it was the last one that he was intimately involved in designing. And you look at that and you see these animatronic figures, which he was very proud of, and they basically do this, and that's about it. And their faces are expressionless, and you're in a boat that is tethered to something under the water, so you know that there's water all around you, but you never quite feel you're floating. And you're immersed in a nice experience, one of my favorite attractions, but we could do a lot better. So if you look at Pirates in Shanghai, you are, first of all, we're using the highest end projection equipment available, and you are essentially in a boat going through an IMAX theater that is all around you. So at one point you look up and there are we simulate you sinking underwater, and you actually feel like you're underwater, in part because of the cinema that we use around you. But you look up and there are sharks swimming overhead. The ride system, instead of being tethered, we have a very, very sophisticated magnet driving system that actually moves all of the boats. So they're never tethered to the ground, they're floating, and that creates a different experience. The other thing it gives us the ability to do is to spin them around, to turn them mm-hmm. sideways, and to do other things that give you much more immersive feeling than you would there. So that's just one example. We also built a coaster that's one of the greatest, maybe the greatest coaster that exists in the world, based on what were called light cycles in the Tron movie. And you get
Can I tell people that you were on our Christmas card riding the Tron?
I was,
ride.
Yes, I had to do that.
With our younger son. Somehow I got out of that shot. No,
yeah, you did, actually. It did wonders to your hair.
Exactly.
But you get on this vehicle that looks like a high-end motorcycle, and it shoots you out of the building at 60 miles an hour, which doesn't sound that fast except when you're on it, and you're not seatbelted in. We figured out a way that you are secured, I promise. And I've ridden it, I don't know, 30 times, 10 in one day. By the way, when you're in my job, you get to test these things before the public does. So you get on them and you look at the other vehicles and they all have sandbags on them. You're basically a crash test dummy.
You're the crash test dummy, yep. Mm-hmm.
But we figured out a way that you could get on them and we could keep you safe and you're not seatbelted in, because if you're seatbelted in, it changes the experience completely. So we've done a lot with technology to enhance the experience, and one of the things that has excited me so much about technology, not just imagery that we create for movies and how we distribute, but the ultimate park experience. And it's not, it's actually real VR. I shouldn't say real VR, it's real. Not V, there's no V, it is reality. I've actually exhorted our team to not create virtual reality experiences at the park, because augmented, yes, but VR, no, because what we create is an experience that feels so real. So when you walk into Cars Land, you feel like you're in Radiator Springs because of what we have built. Not only the attention to detail, but the scale. And VR is ersatz. It doesn't do that. So I don't see much of that in our future there, but AR, definitely opportunities.
And so just give us a look ahead to the domestic, the new stuff coming. So Avatar Land and Star Wars Lands.
Avatar Land opens in May in Orlando, and there's an experience as well, thanks to technology. You get on a Banshee, which is the flying character that was created by Jim Cameron in his movie. And it's you actually sitting on this creature, and you feel, thanks to basically bass sound, you feel a pulse and breathing, and there might be some expansion and maybe a little bit of heat, and you're on this thing, and all of a sudden a screen comes up, and you are in Pandora. And it's actually a 3D ride through, but your vehicle is never leaving its base. It's right there, but you feel like you're right in it. It's sensational. And we also used modern robotics there, including robotics that create expression. Mm-hmm. One of the things that with a lot of robotics that are used to basically imitate or copy human beings is the facial expressions are virtually non-existent. We've spent a lot of time and a lot of money on robots that have expression. And there is a Navi, which is the character from Avatar 2. By the way, that wasn't even our movie, but we licensed it, that has expressions that you will not believe in terms of how Navi-like, I was going to say human, how Navi-like they are. And then we're doing we're building two gigantic Star Wars lands, one at Disneyland and one in Orlando. And one of the things you'll be able to do there is get in the cockpit of the Millennium Falcon and go for a joyride. And I've ridden that. We haven't built it, but I've ridden that in a
simulation.
Imagineering simulation lab, and it's pretty good, really good.
So we have just a couple minutes left, and we promised a little update on your news. I thought you were going to be hanging around the house come 2018, and apparently that's not the case.
You were my role model. You signed up for 5 years as dean of the Annenberg School. I had to find something to do quickly. So I announced today that I'm extending CO, but for 1 year beyond my tenure, which isn't momentous news, really, but just to put it in perspective, I've done this job for almost 12, and I was slated to leave in the middle of 18, which would have been long enough, I thought, in the job, just in terms of not only a feeling of accomplishment, but getting the company in a position that I thought would be good for my successor, whomever that is. Succession is a complicated thing, and we felt, meaning the board and I felt, we could use more time to not only spend on succession, but to create a better transition. And so we mutually agreed to win on another year, and that's what I'm doing.
Okay.
And I feel great about it. But I'm serious this time around. No matter what you're doing, I promise. It's interesting because a lot of people have said, well, you have the greatest job in the world. Like, why would you give it up? In a nice way, a lot of people say, I'm 66. Hey, you look young. You have a lot of energy. And I know 66 today isn't what it was back in our youth. But... it's interesting what happens when you're in jobs like mine as long as you are and the company has done fairly well. A few things happen. One, you get drawn outside the company a lot, like this. People want you to speak and get awards and be on boards and be of council and do all these different things. And that can be very distracting. And I found that I've fought hard not to fall prey to that. But I will say you have to fight harder at it, particularly with a company like ours that's so well known. And I think staying too long makes that even harder. And the other thing that happens is you, even though I'm perfectly motivated, you start, I found...
Perfectly motivated is really an understatement.
Yeah, maybe. But you start believing your own convictions the longer you've made them. And when the bets or the convictions prove to be right more than wrong, you get really confident in your own convictions, and you can easily get more dismissive of other people's ideas and other people's convictions. And so I want to be really careful that I leave at a time when I'm not only feeling like I'm at the top of my game, but when it's absolutely right for me and the company. And that's what this is all about.
Before we let you go, anything you'd like to share with us about what you're thinking about next? Life after Disney?
No. No, I'm not thinking much about it. I'm somewhat wistful about some of it. It's hard for me while I'm doing this job to spend much time, thinking about what's next. I do have a license plate holder in my car that says, "Is there life after Disney?" You've seen that. I decided it's not worth it anymore because I get stopped every once in a while, people wondering what that means. I don't know. I'm not sure. There's a big world. There's a whole world out there for me to enjoy. And after what will then be 45 years at ABC and Disney, it's time.
Well, David Belasco and I can find some things for you to do with your time should you have some free time. Yeah. So on that note, thank you very much for
coming. Thank you, Will. Thank you. I have one privilege here. I can actually kiss my
interviewer.
Thank you.
Thank you.